In its half century of existence, the Barbasol PBA Tournament of Champions has rarely ceased to amaze. From Don Johnson's near perfect game in 1970 to Mike Durbin's historic win in 1984, Jason Couch's amazing three-peat. Kelly Kulick made history in 2010. And Mika Koivuniemi capturing the richest purse of all time. Today in the 50th edition of this great event, will the hottest bowler on the planet, Jason Belmonte, continue his dominance and successfully defend his TOC title? The first PBA Tournament of Champions was staged in Indianapolis in 1962. The 50th edition is ready to roll in front of a sold-out crowd in the newly renovated, beautiful Woodland Bowl. Today's competitors, tournament leader Rhino Page, Jason Belmonte, Ryan Ciminelli, Sean Rash, and Scott Norton. And hello again, everyone. Mike Jakubowski with PBA Hall of Famer Randy Peterson. Kimberly Pressler is reporting laneside today. The Tournament of Champions, the signature event for the PBA, produced so many great moments in its history. We will relive the top three moments as voted on by you, the fans, during today's show. Randy Peterson, Jason Belmonte, the hot topic of conversation this week, coming out of the number two hole.
It's because he's the hottest player on the planet. Jason Belmonte's back once again, fresh off of his major victory last week in Green Bay, Wisconsin. Jason Belmonte is here making his 10th major telecast in his last 12 attempts. He's also looking to successfully defend his Tournament of Champions crown. But waiting in the wings is our number one seed, Rhino Page. It's a very interesting story. Rhino Page, back in 2009, suffered a devastating loss in this event to Patrick Allen when he needed just nine spare. Well, you can see he got four. It's been six long years for Rhino Page, but you know, that's really not the thing that's been weighing heavily on Rhino Page's mind. What has been is a significant wrist injury that required surgery. And coming from experience, having had three knee surgeries myself, I know what it's like for a player to have self-doubt. You always wonder, will I ever be able to get back to that championship form? Well, guess what? Rhino Page is back. He led this tournament from start to finish, and now it's just one win away from capturing this elusive title.
And the tournament leader is standing by with our Kimberly Pressler.
Thanks, guys. Rhino, that 2009 loss at the TOC when you got second place was a pretty tough one for you. But what motivated you this week to capture the number one seed?
It's funny you ask that. I got to see that shot over and over at the Hall of Fame banquet this week. And at first, it really, really hurt. I was like, oh, they got to remind me of that. And after speaking to Norm Duke about it afterwards, you know, he helped me understand it a lot differently. He's been out here a long time. And I came in to qualifying knowing that I was good enough to be out here and more confident than I've been in a very long time.
Well, that's good to hear. And we look forward to seeing you in the final. And guys, back to you.
Rhino Page, emotional, Randy, even here about an hour before he bowls for the title.
Yeah, you could just get a sense of how much it means to him, and it should.
The stepladder starts with Scott Norton versus Sean Rash, Ciminelli, Belmonte, and then Page. Tournament oil conditions laid out in blue. Tournament of Champions pattern to a length of 39 feet.
And 21 300 games this week. Rhino Page averaged just over 246 after the 24 games of qualifying, but this whole pattern gives the players a little bit of left, a little bit of right on both sides of the lane.
Opening shot belongs to Scott Norton. Strike! The oil pattern has the heavier concentrations of blue, and it flattens out to lighter concentrations on the outside part of the lane.
Opening shot now for Sean Rash. 8 PBA Tour titles, a decade on tour out of Montgomery, Illinois. Opening shot for Rash is a strike. Taking a look back at Sean Rash's victory here at the Tournament of Champions in 2012 in Las Vegas.
Yeah, and this win basically secured player of the year for Sean Rash. He rolled a 10 there, nice break, and he made some great shots en route to winning this TOC.
Defeated Ryan Ciminelli in that match, and if Rash should win here, he would get Ciminelli coming up next. But first, Rash versus Norton, strike apiece. Former PBA Player of the Year toes the line here in the second frame. Strike for Rash.
It's going to be a strike fest today, folks. So if you like big scores, you're in for a treat. If you like majors, well, it's that much better. Sean Rash getting off to a perfect start. Goes light the first shot on the right lane and comes back, and this is 10 in the pit. It's always pressure when you bowl on television, but even more so when it's a major championship. The players are going to feel it. There's a lot of hyperventilating going on early in each match.
7 pin.
A little soft 7, and what I mean by that is the 4 pin went to the sidewall and was just kind of passed out in the left gutter. Didn't have enough on it to kick off the sidewall and into the 7 pin.
Scott Spouse is here. Craig Woodward providing support. Sitting right next to Sarah Rash, Sean's wife. Norton cross lane, hits the 7 pin. Norton's last title coming in 2013 at the PBA Earl Anthony Players Championship in Allen Park, Michigan. And we'll get a re-rack here.
Scott told us just the other day, Mike J, that the only thing missing from the family's mantle is a major championship. They've got Hall of Fame awards. A lot of that obviously coming from Scott's mom, Virginia Norton. But the one biggie is that major title, using a delirium today.
Third frame, left lane. Fixing 10 pin.
Again, and just not hard enough into the pins, just comes in a little light, doesn't carry the shaker. Very unique style, we'll get into that just a little bit later. And good enough shot to strike, but the pins don't cooperate. So imperative in a one game match to be a good spare shooter. You cannot avoid an open frame, especially when the scoring pace is high.
Covers a spare for Norton. Sean Rash working a double. He's got 8 PBA Tour titles. Last one coming at the 2014 Wolf Open during the PBA Summer Swing. Rash a strike back here in the first frame, now operating in the third, working the double in a short lead. Opening match, Barbasol PBA Tournament of Champions. Talking to Sean about this yesterday, Randy, every once in a while, all the wheels are not in motion for Rash.
Yeah, you don't have to tell me, I know.
Well, he just was warned the shot clock violation. First warning, the first offense is a warning. Second offense is a fine.
Between third and fourth arrow, mixing, and he slaps a 10 out.
Yeah, that 16-pound bowling ball with a lot of speed and revolutions tends to create really good pin carry, and you saw it there as the 10, excuse me, as the 4 pin, as the 6 pin goes to the sidewall and kicks a 10 out. Watch the second pin from the right. That's the difference between Rash carrying the corner pin and Scott Norton leaving it.
Randy, Sean mentioned to us that he has modified his starting position. And he's not trying to grab it as much.
Right, he's not cupping it as much at the start.
puts the 8 and the 9.
A little less cup at the start of his wrist puts less tension in his swing. The less tension you have, the freer your arm swing is, the less the tendency is to grab it. So it looks like he's starting with a little bit flatter wrist, but now he still has a cup wrist at the top, but helps him keep his swing a lot more relaxed, and therefore he can free-willy it at the bottom of the swing.
Back over to Scott Norton. He says, if you don't live for this situation, you should probably be doing something else. Fourth frame. Fixing. Three pin.
I don't know if Scott's experiencing carry down or transition. You know, a lot of times on the left side, they don't see a whole lot of transition, the southpaws, and there's three southpaws on the telecast today. So it's the one thing that, you know, it has always kind of perplexed me, if you will, is what they actually see on their side of the lane, not left-handed.
Three straight single pin conversions for Scott Norton.
Scott's never been in this position before. As you see what these two players did against one another in match play, he defeated Sean Rash 245-235, but Scott's never bowled for a major title. Sean Rash won this tournament. Sean Rash, former player of the year. Sean Rash is a beast out here, but he's given Scott Norton all he wants early on.
Strike for Norton. And Randy, Scott said yesterday, I tend to like right more than left. What did he mean?
He likes to move right and open the lane up a little bit more than most people would think. At least on that shot there, he got the ball to drive through the pins correctly, and the four pin went to the sidewall, cut the seven out, and that's what he's been looking for.
Front four for Rash, fifth frame. Six around the 10. Family always very important to Sean Rash. Wife Diana, or rather wife Sarah, and his mom Diana. Also baby Kaylee, never too far behind.
Sean missed match play last week at the Masters by 20 pins, said he missed way too many spares. And again, one of the other things he was working on is we take a look at his arsenal, LT48 vintage. I seem to remember the LT48 being named after some guy named Petraglia.
Johnny P, Hall of Famer, the original LT48. Squeaks to the line, sixth frame. Six around the 10.
Two pretty good shots there that went back to back ringing tens. And if you're Scott Norton, this is exactly what the doctor ordered because now it gives you a chance to get back into this match.
Rash on the spare. Leads by 30 pins, opening match at the Barbasol PBA Tournament of Champions. The winner gets Ryan Ciminelli. From the left, it's Scott Norton trying to pick up 30 pins against Sean Rash from the right. More coming live from Indianapolis. The 50th Barbasol PBA Tournament of Champions is brought to you by Barbasol. Life is full of close shaves. Make sure your close shave is a Barbasol close shave. By Geico, saving people money on more than just car insurance. By AMF, roll this way. And by Hammer Bowling, nothing hits like a hammer. Twelve past champions of this Tournament of Champions, winners in this field of 113 competition this week at Woodland Bowl. X Extra Frame Tournament highlights of position round.
And Rhino Page led from the opening bell and never looked back. Jason Belmonte bowling him in position round, looking to secure the number two seed, just absolutely shreds the rack.
Heading into the position round match, Ryan Ciminelli trailed Sean Rash by just 14 pins for the number three seed.
He would beat Sean Rash to hold on to the number three seed.
The battle for fifth and final seed came down to 3-for-1 spot.
O'Neill needs a strike here in his shot in the 10th frame to secure the fifth and final spot. He gets eight, setting up the stage for that man, Scott Norton. Norton would need a double and eight to lock himself on the telecast. He gets the first hit. There's the second hit. And all Patrick Allen can do is just sit back and watch.
Strike out for Scott Norton to qualify for the number five seed. Top five qualifiers, 238.8 needed. And Bill O'Neill just missing out. Patrick Allen, seventh. Parker Bone, the third, eighth. Liz Johnson, top ladies finisher, finishing in ninth position. PBA Hall of Famers Mark Roth and Carmen Salvino. Carmen Randy Baldwin, the first Tournament of Champions and the 50th.
He's just a great guy. I have huge respect for both of those players, Mark Roth and Carmen Salvino. I was fortunate enough to win a tournament with Carmen, and it's always great anytime you can have some of the legends out at our events.
Good one here.
Speaking of legends,
Marshall Holman will join us in the booth for the next match. But first, the conclusion of our opening match. Norton trails by 30, can cut it to 20 with a strike. Sixth frame. High. Six pin.
Yeah, and that's just the tendency of the ball just going a little bit too long. And a player instinctively will try to help the ball to make it hook up into the pocket. And it looked like Scott just tried to give that one a little extra. You see just how violently this ball hooks in the back part of the lane. And he had a great opportunity there to get back in this match. If he could have struck in the sixth and seventh frame, he could have reduced Sean's lead to 10.
Spare for Scott Norton. Randy, it's time for Track Tech Talk.
Let's take a look at Scott Norton's game. It's real old school to me, and versus the modern game. He's got very late timing. This is what was taught to us back in the 70s and 80s. You can see just how deliberate and how late he is getting the ball into the backswing, which forces him to really wait on it. The tendency when you get the ball into the swing that late is to pull down from the top, but he's great at leaving his swing alone and allowing gravity and the weight of the bowling ball to bring that arm forward.
Seventh frame opening match, Norton trails by 30. Left lane.
All right, come on.
Great shot there, but does he have enough time? Sean Rash hasn't missed the pocket in six frames. Starts with a front four and goes back-to-back ringing tens, and he's just locked in.
Rash has got two major wins on his resume, the 2007 Masters at Miller Park in Milwaukee and the 2012 Tournament of Champions at Red Rock in Vegas. Working on a spare, seventh frame. Strike for Sean Rash. At seven, Michael Young leads the Panthers. Upset hopes against Malcolm Brogdon and the Cavaliers. Then the Jayhawks balanced attack battles the full court press of the Mountaineers in a premier Big 12 matchup. Pitt versus number two Virginia at seven, then number eight Kansas and 21st ranked West Virginia at nine. Monday on ESPN, part of Rivalry Week, presented by Wendy's. Key shot here, Randy. A double can extend the lead for Rash.
It takes it to 40 with only three frames left for Norton.
Messenger? No, 10-pin.
Almost a pocket 7-10. Well, Scott Norton's just got a very small little shining light that he can just barely see. This is nearing the end. Sean Rash has thrown eight quality shots.
Tournament of Champions history, five players out of the 49 tournaments have run the ladder in the history of this event. As Rash resets, cross lane, 10-pin square. Field of 113 players at the PBA Tournament of Champions, all PBA Tour, Regional Tour, PBA 50 and Women's Series champions eligible to enter. Liz Johnson, of course, we mentioned, finished ninth. Brian Valletta, 18th. Eugene McCune, Patrick Dombrowski, and the twin Finn Ascu Palermo jumped in as the alternate. Mike Fagan retired due to injury. Strike for Norton, cuts the lead to 20.
Well, max score right now for Scott Norton, 238. Sean Rash is only at 228. So this is going to come down to the 10th frame. Scott Norton, in my opinion, to have any chance, he's got a strike on this ball. Well, no week seven there. You split that rack open. Seven and the 10 pin just get split wide apart, and he needed that. Now he has set himself up for a 10th frame finale, depending on what Sean Rash does. Now, Sean Rash can strike out in the 9th and 10th and shut out Scott.
Foundation frame for Rash. Six slaps the 10 out.
Two more in the 10th, and he will advance. Second pin from the right. Six pin just caves the 10 in.
Rash saying, I'd love to bowl the entire season here. I love the venue. I love the host. I love the fans. Plus, my ball strikes here. A couple strikes here, and Sean Rash will advance to face Ryan Ciminelli in the next match. Jason Belmonte awaits in the semifinal. Rhino Page is your tournament leader. Six gets the 10.
That was a pretty late 10, Mike J, but it still fell, and he's just one strike away now.
Takes his second re-rack. You saw him with that hand motion. He's really trying to control.
Yeah, he gets too jacked up. He gets ahead of himself. He starts to balk, and bad things happen. So he's trying to take as much time as possible. There's the re-rack. Perfectly legal what he's doing. He's waiting for the pins to reset. And it, quite honestly, it's a smart play, especially for players that tend to get a little overexcited and get jacked up. Take as much time as you need. Make sure that you're set before you throw this all-important shot here.
Baker, eight.
Oh, that was just a bizarre hit. I'm not sure the last time I saw a hit like this leave an eight pin. This is just a light swish hit. And the five pin, instead of going to the left, went straight back. Scott Norton now can strike out and win.
.237 for Rash. Looks awfully like the position round.
Well, last time Scott Norton was in this position, he had to throw a double and eight just to make the telecast. Now he needs all three to move on to the next match.
And emphasizing something Scott said earlier, if you don't live for this, Randy, you should probably be doing something else.
He's only struck once on this right lane as well. So see what happens here in the 10th frame. I'm not really sure what to expect, to be honest.
7 pip.
That's it. Sean Rash will move on.
Just a bit short for Scott Norton, and Sean Rash will advance and face Ryan Ciminelli. Top five finish for Scott Norton at the Tournament of Champions. Sean Rash will advance in a rematch in Tournament of Champions history. Rash, Ciminelli, when we return to Woodland Bowl at the Barbasol PBA Tournament of Champions. There are t-shirts in India that read, if cricket is religion, then Sachin is God. The Little Master is the story of that religion and the man, Sachin Tendulkar, who is considered the greatest cricket player in history. ESPN Films, The Little Master, tonight at 8 on ESPN. Fans of the PBA voted online to decide the top three moments in Tournament of Champions history, and we will go through the top three as voted on by the fans. Here is moment number three from the 2011 Tournament of Champions at Red Rock in Vegas, the lowest game ball in PBA history on television. Tom Doherty owning a 100 game. At the same time, Major Mika Koivuniemi just misses a perfect game on his way to the largest prize in PBA history with a win over Tom Smallwood in the title match. Major Mika, the number three moment in Tournament of Champions history. Updated stepladder. Final score, Sean Rash 237 over Scott Norton 215. Rash advances to face lefty Ryan Ciminelli. Belmonte and Page await on the ladder. When we return to Woodland Bowl, it's a rematch from a final match in Tournament of Champions history. And Hall of Famer Marshall Holman joins us next live at Woodland Bowl. The 50th Barbasol PBA Tournament of Champions kicked off its week with the PBA Hall of Fame induction dinner on Tuesday night. PBA 50 player Bob Glass honored with 9 senior titles. Barb Wilt serving the PBA for more than 4 decades. And one of the 3 Microsoft executives that purchased the PBA back in 2000, Chris Peters, honored the 2015 class of PBA Hall of Famers. 3-time PBA 50 Player of the Year is Glass, Chris Peters, and Barb Wilt, honored here in Indianapolis. Barb Wilt is on hand next to Jim Doty. Thank you, Barb. 40-plus years of service to the Professional Bowlers Association. Mike Jakubowski with 2 Hall of Famers, Marshall Holman and Randy Peterson. And Marshall, what did you see in that first match from Sean Rash?
Well, he had a very good look, but his carry was not that good. In fact, he left a very strange 8-pin in the second shot in the 10th that would have shut out Scott Norton, but worked out for him. Scott left the flat 7, so Rash, he continues.
I think any time you're a power player and you flush the pocket 10 shots in a row and you only come away with 237, I think that is an area of concern. Marshall, I don't know about you, but back in the day when you hit the pocket a lot, I think you expected to strike more often than not.
Yeah.
And you did that quite a bit. But you know what? I think carry is created by the ball going through the pins the correct way. And, boy, you were pretty good at it, my friend.
1986. Yes, that was fun. What happened to that guy?
Well,
Old hand on the lanes and old hand in the booth. Marshall's going to join us to call action as we roll on. Our next match features Sean Rash and Ryan Ciminelli.
A lot of moving around.
Number three seed, Ciminelli, will take on Rash, who has advanced. Barbasol PBA Tournament of Champions rolls on. The number three seed, Randy, has opted to begin here.
That's got to be based on ball reaction per lane. And obviously, he likes the right lane a little bit better than the left lane.
It'll be interesting to see Scott Norton, his look on the lane wasn't all that great, but he throws the ball a lot straighter than Ciminelli. Maybe with Ciminelli opening up the lane, he'll have a better shot on the left-hand side. That ball just crept just a little bit high, left the four, excuse me, the six pin.
Two-time PBA Tour titleist picks up the spare. Sean Matt Rash moving along now. Para majors for Rash, looking for his third here today at Woodland Bowl. PBA Player of the Year, he earned that honor in the 2011-12 season.
The ball of choice in the way he's playing the lanes, his ball reaction is very smooth.
Yeah, yeah, it's a very, very good look. I was sitting right behind him in that opening match, and the ball reaction is very smooth. He's very comfortable. This is a moment where he is in his element.
Marshall Holman on that list of multiple Tournament of Champions winners.
It's back when the balls were square.
No lignum vitae in that bag. Rash on the strike, second frame. 6-10, Messenger, yeah!
Oh my gosh, that's a strange Messenger ring and 10.
Yeah, that's a ring and 10 that gets taken out. Something we didn't see back in our day, Marshall. It was a ring and 10 all the way. And
yeah,
that's why you put power and speed on a bowling ball.
And your Barbasol close shave of the day as the head pin. Double blades, the 10 pin for a strike. Ciminelli on the right lane. 10 back.
Ryan Ciminelli telling us yesterday that he did a lot of hard work not too long ago with Mike Jasnow in Reno. Spent some time in Reno last summer and basically changed his first and second step to try to decrease the muscle in his swing. Did a lot of work mentally as well.
That's something I never had to worry about, was muscle in the swing.
Ryan calls himself a different player completely. Third frame now, working on the strike.
Oh, go.
6-8 split.
Well, he didn't like it off his hand. You could hear him say, go. He knew that ball was going to creep in high, and really, he pays the ultimate price for a shot that wasn't terrible. It was just a little bit wrong off his hand.
Open frame for Ciminelli.
You know, Marshall, one of the things that I was real excited about when I found out that you'd be in the booth with us, and then I saw who made the telecast, was having a discussion with you about multiple left-handers on the show. And it just seems to me that when you get more than one lefty on, a lot of things kind of happen on their side of the lane, and it almost looks at times that they're really not prepared for it.
Yeah, well, it's unusual to have more than one. And we have three this week, as we see Rash, who's just, he's very comfortable right now. He's at the front three. He did exactly what he needed to do. Ciminelli gives him an opening. He steps right into it and increases his lead by another 10 pins. But yeah, there's more carry down on the left-hand side of the lane with three lefties, and it will be interesting to see what happens, and especially as we get to our title match, you know, with Rhino Page waiting to bowl that one game for the Barbasol Championship.
Kimberly Pressler is with Scott Norton.
Thanks, Mike. So, Scott, you were having an issue with the corner pins on both lanes. How do you think the lanes are playing right now?
Well, I had a little more problem, I think, on the right lane than Ryan might, because it looks like the left lane's being a little tricky for him. Right lane just seemed a little bit wet, dry. Got up in the 10th with an opportunity ball in hand to win the match, and I threw it great, and that's really all you can do. And I just want to thank the guys at EBI, Columbia Track Hammer, for making the best brands in bowling, and to a Vice Inserts, and to my husband, Craig, for coming out and watching me bowl one game.
Well, thank you so much for your time, Scott. Guys, back to you in the booth.
Well, you heard him mention right there that just in the one game and practice, right lane got clipped. That's what they term wet dry now. And the left lane was a little suspect. And again, it just seems like it's kind of hard to understand for the novices that are watching in as to how quickly the lanes can transition.
Well, the bowling balls are so strong, and they just take the oil from the front and they throw it down the back of the lane. You can see with this colored oil, you can see how it dissipates in the front, and it heads on back towards the pins.
Ciminelli trails by 42, fifth frame, can cut into that lead. Mixing strike, blast the six out of it.
He's a strong player.
I tell you what, I really like the changes he's made. I mean, that's about as clean as I've ever seen his footwork go into the foul line.
Sean Rash has the front four. He became the 23rd player in PBA history to roll a perfect game on television at the summer swing at the 2014 PBA Wolf Open. He's got a 32-pin lead, fifth frame. Can extend it with a strike.
You know, on the right side of the lane, Marshall, when the lanes break down or you're following a power player, you know what to do. You just got to move inside of where that power player was to try to find the oil line again. And, you know, Sean Rash has pretty much got the right side of the lane to himself right now. Belmonte hasn't touched the lane since practice. And right now, Sean Rash has got a pretty nice blueprint to the pocket.
Yeah, he's with every strike he throws, it really does become a little easier.
My kid.
As we mentioned, Kaylee, never too far behind as Sarah Rash and Mom Diana enjoying the moment.
He knows his little girl.
Plus 42 can really step on the gas here, sixth frame. Down goes the gas pedal. Sean Rash, six-pack out of the gate. And a commanding lead against Ryan Ciminelli. The winner gets Jason Belmonte in the semifinal. More of our match when we return to the Barbasol Tournament of Champions. Super Tuesday presented by Cree LED Lighting at 7. The pursuit of perfection continues for Kentucky as John Calipari's Cats battle the upset-minded Vols. Number one Kentucky, Tennessee at 7. Then Michigan State, Michigan Tuesday on ESPN, part of Rivalry Week, presented by Wendy's.
Yeah, Kentucky 25 in a row, I believe.
And oh,
yeah.
Can they go all the way? A lot of attention there, and our attention now on Ryan Ciminelli, double working. He needs to throw the rest of these strikes in this game.
Yeah, for any chance.
Ooh, seven pin.
Oh, that was good.
Yes, it was.
Powerful kid.
Wow.
He's got a great lower body, a lot of strength. But I still like what he's doing. I think it's the cleanest I've ever seen it out of his hand as well. Mm-hmm. Approach looks solid. You know, Marshall, as you know, it takes a lot for a player to go through a major change and then use it in competition.
Yeah, because trust it. Sure, because it's easy to fall back into what feels comfortable. And what feels comfortable is what that's what he was trying to change. And done a good job.
Ryan Ciminelli's arsenal, he's got the Diva Divine. The hook rating is on a maximum hook scale of 10. So he's got the strongest ball in his bag. Seventh frame.
Apparently that's the wrong ball, because those were aced.
Chelsea Ciminelli and Angelo, wife and pop here. Family support always a part of a Ciminelli bowling experience.
Yeah, it's got to be tough for them. You know, the game happens so fast, and, yeah. You know, leaves a 6-8 in the third frame, and Rash has got all these strikes, and it's there's not enough time to catch up.
Yeah, and you just heard him say, apparently it's the wrong ball because I just aced the last two shots. And anytime you do that in today's game, you ace the shot and you leave a ringing 7 for a left-hander, a ringing 10 for a right-hander, the ball's not going through the pins the correct way.
Rash has got a big lead in the front six, looking to advance into a semifinal with Jason Belmonte, seventh frame.
Oh, God.
Looked good, Randy. What did you see? Marshall?
Looked like he got it in, but it was plenty of oil in the middle part of the lane, and it held.
Yeah, he didn't like it at all off his hand.
I'll regroup.
Sure looked good on the back end, and Sean's going to take a re-rack.
I think he pulled it, but he also came over the top for a little bit, so the ball went longer through the heads. Looked great at the back end. If he hadn't said anything, everybody would have thought it was a great shot.
Exactly.
Sam Rash liked it. Great packed house here at Woodland Bowl. Newly renovated, $3.5 million renovation. This great bowling facility, even greater. Now Rash front seven.
Has he ever had a 300 on TV?
Yes, he has. He had the 23rd. Real close. Eight bagger for Rash.
Interesting that Sean Rash had the 23rd televised 300 game. The 24th televised 300 game was by Ronnie Russell against Sean Rash.
Columbia 300 fun fact, 27 of the first 28 PBA Tournament of Champions events were won by players who are currently members of the Hall of Fame. Strike for Ciminelli.
Well, he made a ball change. And again, Marshall, I think you make a great point in that it's so fast. You got to come out of the gate with conviction as to what ball you're going to throw, where you're going to stand, and where you're going to look.
Absolutely. The guy who wins the match always has a little bit of an edge on the guy coming out getting ready to bowl. Although you want to qualify as high as possible.
Strike for Ciminelli. Couple things on our agenda. Rash and a potential round number and a dynamite semifinal.
Well, I think it's the semifinal us bowling fans have been waiting for. Sean Rash against Jason Belmonte. I mean, they've got a history. And we'll get into that a little bit more after Sean throws this next shot.
No one has ever thrown two perfect games on television. Ninth frame. Wes Mallott did it in a non-title event, but Sean Rash has got the front nine.
And Mrs. Rash is having a very good time. As well she should.
The match is in hand. Rash will finish first. Marshall, what's that thought when you get that nine bagger?
Well, he's just trying to control his body so that he can just continue to do what he's done. You know, you don't change anything. He's got nine strikes in a row. He's very well lined up. He's comfortable. He knows exactly what to do. So just come on, body. Just do what you know how to do.
And we'll get a reset.
And he does that frequently.
I guess if I didn't use rosin, I wouldn't get my eyes. All right, regroup.
Let's put the rosin on the ball in your hand.
Agreed.
Rosin in the right place, ball in hand, 10 frame, front nine.
Oh, hook a lot.
Can opener for 10.
To say that he has a little bit of area would be an understatement. That's what you, but as a bowler, that's what you're looking for. You're looking for the right ball in your hand to optimize how much you can miss on the lane left and right and still get away with it, because you can't, you're not going to split the board every time.
A little friction to the right. Nothing wrong with that.
Can join Jack beyond a little, the first to ever throw a perfect game on television.
If I'm Jason Belmonte, I'm rooting for Sean Rash to throw 300.
Absolutely.
Because it's hard to come back down to earth.
Absolutely.
After you do something extraordinary.
I couldn't have said it better myself.
Beyond a little did it in the Tournament of Champions. Now Rash can match the feat and get two perfect games on television. He's looking for the 23rd and the 25th. Match in hand, he will face Belmonte. Sean Rash has one ball and a date with history.
Well, I would certainly have to say he will do it.
Two more games, baby. Just need two more games.
That's all.
Dude, I'm starting to pay my mortgage off with these numbers.
12 strikes in a row, 300 for Sean Rash. And a $10,000 bonus and advancing to the semifinal with Belmonte. Do not leave. We're coming back to Indy. The 50th Barbasol PBA Tournament of Champions is brought to you by Barbasol. Life is full of close shaves. Make sure your close shave is a Barbasol close shave. By Rotogrip, your time is now. Own it. By HotelPlanner.com, the best place to book hotel rooms. Best rooms, best rate, guaranteed. And by DV8, we are DV8. Tonight, we bowl.
Got to be terrific on Jack.
Jack Biondolillo became the first ever to roll a 300 game on live national television. And Sean Rash just backed it up with the 25th perfect game in televised history at the Tournament of Champions. And the money ball, Randy.
Well, can't throw it much better than that for the wheat. It was just a great shot. The six went to the wall, got enough for the 10, and it's pretty good stuff.
Big thanks to Marshall Holman for joining us for that moment in PBA history. Kimberly Pressler is laneside.
I am. I'm with a very excited Sean Rash, but you were the only person in history to have two perfect games on TV. what's this moment like for you?
Yeah, it's great. I mean, it's nice to bowl a good game. The focus now is to bowl another competitor, make some good shots, and hopefully give myself a chance to bowl for the title, because that's what we're here for.
How do you recoup now? You're going up against Belmonte.
Just go through the same process. Use the bathroom, drink some water, talk to the coach, Chuck, and Ryan and Brian, and everybody that's helped me all week, and just keep my composure right and have fun, because that's what we're here for.
It sure is. Good luck to you today. Back to you in the booth.
25th perfect game in the history of the PBA. And let's flashback now to 2013 and the number two Tournament of Champions moment is voted on by you, the fans. 2013, Pete Weber wrote another chapter in his storied career when he captured the TOC title against Jason Belmonte, becoming the oldest player ever to win the Tournament of Champions. Weber's second TOC title to go along with five US Opens, two PBA World Championships, and a PBA Touring Players Championship. Updated stepladder. Sean Rash, perfect 300 to Ryan Ciminelli's 214. And yes, there's more to come. Jason Belmonte now versus Sean Rash in the semifinal match. And Jason Belmonte involved in a little bit of controversy last week in Green Bay. Last week at the USBC Masters in Wisconsin, things off to a good start for Pete Weber in the semifinal against Jason Belmonte. But then Jason Belmonte's towel on the ball and a couple of crossover hits irritating Pete Weber. Weber would go on to strike against Belmo. And Belmonte would throw it right back to the 10th frame, with Weber needing three hits to tie. Jason Belmonte advancing to the title match, and Pete Weber not happy.
He kept putting his towel on the ball return, and I don't want the stuff on my bowling ball, you know, because I don't wipe my ball off. So whatever's on his towel is getting on my ball. That's what I got upset about.
Randy, this happening last week, and there is no rule in the rule book for this.
No. Jason Belmonte didn't do anything wrong. I mean, I think that to even remotely consider what Jason Belmonte did last week was somehow against the rules or poor sportsmanship is ridiculous. I mean, if anything, you could maybe argue that about what Weber said to him coming off the lanes. I mean, look, the bottom line is Jason Belmonte is in everybody's head out here on this tour, and he's the most scrutinized player out here. So anything that he does, I mean, it just gets overanalyzed, and it gets turned into something that it's not. Jason Belmonte was asked not to put his towel back up on the bowling balls on the bar turn. It's not a rule. He continued to do it, and you know why? Because it's purely out of habit. You've got two players that are trying to win a major championship. The last thing this player is going to do is think about something other than what he normally does when he goes through his pre-shot routine. I think the whole thing was ridiculous. So does Jason Belmonte, and that's why he didn't comment on it.
Jason Belmonte not answering questions on or off camera. He considers the matter closed. Jason Belmonte and Sean Rash have a history of their own, and they meet head-to-head in the semifinal match, next here live in Indy. Big Monday presented by Verizon. Pitt versus number two Virginia at 7, then number 8 Kansas, and 21st ranked West Virginia at 9. Part of Rivalry Week presented by Wendy's. Kimberly Pressler is with Jason Belmonte.
Thanks, Mike. Jason, you are on one of the most impressive runs in the sport's history. Last week you won the Masters 3 times in a row. No one's ever done that. You're back-to-back player of the year. What's it like? What runs through your mind when you hear people say that you are the best bowler in the world?
It's what I was, hoping for when I was a little kid. This is what my dream was, and this is why I leave my country and my family is to be the best in the world. I wouldn't do it if I didn't think it was possible, and I'm just riding this roller coaster and having a lot of fun while I'm doing it.
All right, then. Well, we look forward to seeing how you do today. Good luck. Bye to both of you.
Jason Belmonte, Sean Rash, semifinal. Rash after the 25th perfect game in PBA Tour history. And Randy, the plot just gets thicker. The action gets better. Great semifinal tilt.
Yeah, don't blink. You might miss the fireworks. Okay.
Opening shot from Rash in the semifinal. Kicks the 10 out for a strike.
Well, these guys aren't going to go out to dinner after this match is over, I can promise you that.
They are as competitive as it gets.
Well, that's a nice way of saying they don't care for each other much, Mike.
They have different styles, personally and on the lanes. And they like to beat each other. High 4-6 split on the opening shot.
It's your best shot.
Well, not a very good shot for Jason out of the gate. He knew it. He paid the price, 4-6 split to start.
Fans the count, 8 out for Belmonte.
That's pretty close, actually. 4-6 is pretty hard to convert any way you shake it.
This is just an unbelievable stat, but Jason Belmonte has made the television finals in 10 of the last 12 majors with 4 wins. He is the 2-time and defending PBA Player of the Year. He's a defending champion of this event. He's coming off a three-peat at the USBC Masters.
Hey, Mike, let's not forget that. If he doesn't lose to Weber at the 2013 Tournament of Champions, he's going for a three-peat of this event as well.
Jason Couch, the only person ever who won 3 consecutive Tournament of Champions. Rash on the front, 13. Frame 2. And the first non-strike is a 4-pin.
Nice break there. Belmonte leaves the 4-6, only the 4-pin for Rash.
Here's a look at the head-to-head matchup between Rash and Belmonte. This is in TV finals with PBA titles on the line. Belmonte owns this matchup 2-0 lifetime.
On that 2013 PBA Tournament of Champions, both players lofting the left gutter cap. We're all sitting waiting for Weber to take the lanes, thinking, is Weber going to have any lane to throw his ball on? And sure enough, Weber comes out and just mows him.
10-pin.
That ball there actually stopped right in front of the pocket, leaving the flat 10. And this is how quickly Jason Belmonte can change an oil pattern with his high rev rate. And the players talk about it out here all the time. And Jason got practice balls before the start of this match. All of a sudden, Rash has got a ball that goes high, and then he's got another one that actually rolls out and stops.
Roltec tournament stats. Strike percentage for Jason Belmonte, 72.9%. .389 out of 534 strikes. Looking to double here. Third frame. That's high.
Get
4-pin.
Ah.
A lot of friction being created right now. Sean, you know, when we saw Sean the first couple of matches, he was just kind of stroking it and playing that really soft little smooth arc into the pocket, and all of a sudden Belmonte comes out and he just starts heaving it. And that right lane looks like it's on fire.
And Rash said earlier, it depends on what Belmonte wants to do during practice. If he tears up the middle, we're in trouble.
Belmonte actually chose to finish on the left lane. Well, players will just keep moving left. They know they have friction to the right. They'll keep moving left and start opening up that angle and start sending the ball to the right. Moving left will create a little bit more push to help the bowling balls get to the right and then get back as you take a look at Belmonte's arsenal going with a high road.
The high road, middle of the road as far as hook rating. The 7 represents a potential hook scale on a scale of 10. Light avoids the 210, just the 2.
You had your own way, man.
Bad shot by Belmonte. Looked like he got fast. Again, that might have something to do with his ball reaction on the right lane. And just trying to get comfortable right now. And boy, you would think with all that power revolutions that if there's any friction to the right, the ball would get back. That time it didn't.
Spare for Belmonte, and Kimberly Pressler is laneside with Ryan Ciminelli.
Thanks, Mike. Ryan, you seemed to question your ball selection pretty early on in your match. Why was that?
We were between the divine and the hooligan in practice, and my ball rev told me that his gut was telling him the hooligan. Mine told me the divine, that's the one I started with, and by the time I repped those 2 7 pins, and I was just too far back when I made the ball change, and it was just the wrong ball choice.
Are you happy to be part of that 300, though, that was out there with your friend Sean Rash?
Yeah, definitely. Being teammates, you know, we room together, we go overseas together. It's nice to see him actually finish that game out and shoot the 300.
Well, even though you didn't win today, you still made Western New York proud. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
Back to you guys in the booth.
Sean Rash. Oh, sorry, Mike Jay, go ahead.
Ryan Ciminelli, just a top finish. It's always a great finish to make a top five in a major.
Absolutely. Anytime you make a telecast in a major, it's good stuff. Disappointing that you don't come away with a victory. Right now, lots of things going the right way for Sean Rash as he rolled the 10 late there.
And trying to take advantage now, fifth frame, leads by 12, semifinal match. Rhino Page awaits in the title match.
Parlay, come on!
And out.
Throw that good.
Comes Rash with the double.
Oh, started early.
Great shot.
Throws the double, and then runs it out to Belmonte.
Come on! Throw that good.
Belmo up quickly, fifth frame on the spare. A little wide, and a 10 pin. Belmo's lost.
It's just late getting there. You know, the angle looked fine, but it's just a little slow getting back to the pocket. He leaves this half 10 because the ball was actually coming in from behind the head pin. And anytime that happens, it's usually that half 10 or that little shaker 10.
Covers the spare, Belmonte. Halfway through our semifinal, Jason trails by 23.
He's going to the rack. He's looking for another ball, and sure enough, he's making a ball change. Or at least he went and got it. Yep, he's making a ball change.
Jason Belmonte's average for the 2012-13 PBA season, 228.8, set the record for the highest average in a single season, beating the previous record set by Norm Duke back in 2006-07. Sixth frame. Ball change strike for Belmonte. Half the game remaining, but to this point it's been Sean Rash with the late follow the 10 pin. And the big double to take the lead. Semifinal match at the Barbasol PBA Tournament of Champions. There are t-shirts in India that read, "If cricket is religion, then Sachin is God." The Little Master is the story of that religion and the man Sachin Tendulkar, who is considered the greatest cricket player in history. ESPN Films, The Little Master, tonight at 8 on ESPN.
We should get t-shirts that say The Little Master on them.
We'll get a cricket league going in the summer. Jason Belmonte moments ago.
First frame was not so good. And then the fourth was just around it and quick, but it's okay. It's still time. Yeah.
Randy, plenty of time.
Well, he's got a great attitude. I don't know about plenty of time. It depends on what Sean Rash does here in the next two frames. But, you know, if Sean doesn't strike here in the sixth and seventh frame, then I say yes, plenty of time.
Double working for Rash, trying to hold down the emotions. Fourth arrow. Six around the 10.
That's a great break for Belmonte. Bad break for Sean Rash. By the way, the 300 game that he bowled last game, it's behind him now. It's gone. It's six frames into this match. He knows exactly what's in front of him. He's bowling his biggest rival out here. The 300 game is well in his rearview mirror.
And he hasn't beaten him in a match with a title as a part of the event. Belly on the 10 pin and a spare. Head over to PBA.com and check out the updated PBA Bowling Challenge mobile game for your iPhone, iPad, and Android devices with more than 12 million downloads. Join your friends today bowling against the best PBA bowlers in dozens of events all over the world. New features include high-performance bowling ball options, PBA League balls. Click on the mobile game at PBA.com and get started. Seventh frame, plus 22 for Sean Rash. Winner advances to the title match. Flush hit.
Well, Belmonte now can get up and strike in the seventh and eighth frame and cut the lead to two. And in my opinion, for Jason to have any chance of winning this match, it's exactly what has to happen.
So I just plug it onto the belt.
Players always wear wireless mics while competing on the PBA Tour, and a quick adjustment. Key shot of the match, seventh frame on a strike for Belmonte. His first chance to double since the third frame. He has struck two times on this left lane, has yet to strike on the right. And he struck on the right lane. It's a 12 pin match.
You notice how much quicker that ball sucked up off of the spot and got flushed to the 1-3, and that's what I was referring to when I said the other ball just came, it just went a little too long and came off of the spot a little too soft. And this ball just looks like somebody kicked it left. One more strike and it's a two pin match.
Also interesting contrast to styles. Rash, so pent up, and Belmo by contrast seems so relaxed.
Oh,
Sean Rash had one of those. Jason Belmonte just did. How does that go wrong?
I don't know what these guys are looking or thinking about when they let go. I mean, there's a little bit of room left and right, but I don't know if Jason thought that this was going to go through the nose or if it was going to go light. I have no idea. Instead, it just ended up dead flush. The question is, what does he do the next time he gets up on that lane?
He didn't see it, so he didn't see the ball reaction. Eighth frame, Rash on a strike and re-extended 12. That's high, four pin.
And the plot thickens. Right now, if Sean Rash spares here, he can strike out for 228. Jason Belmonte can strike out for 236.
Another great semifinal tilt, and Rash will get a re-rack here, I believe.
This is getting very interesting.
Fresh deck for Rash. Two-stick match.
Oh,
2-8-10.
Well, it looks like he moved in a little bit here and got it to the right. The ball just never got back. It's at 2-8-10. It's almost guaranteed to be an open frame. I've made this once in my career.
Rash choosing equipment and trying to think how he's going to approach this. He's got a couple of different ways to try.
Goes for the count. Now he can strike out 204 max. Jason Belmonte is at 206. The next strike puts Belmonte in the teens. How about coming off of a 300 game and needing a double in the 10th to shoot 200 the very next game?
Rash conferring with Tour Rep Chuck Gardner, now Belmonte in the driver's seat, ninth frame. And he takes advantage. Checking out the ball reaction and then a big ball change.
You notice how much quicker that ball's picking up. Now, all of a sudden, he sees a little bit different change of direction down the lane, and he's throwing a ball that he knows will get back to the pocket. One more strike, it's all over. He'll bowl Rhino Page for the title. As it is right now, he just needs a mark.
Patience the key. Rough start, strong finish. Belmonte, 10th frame to advance to another major title match.
How about that finish?
Yes! Yes!
How about the perseverance in that guy?
Tremendous patience to work through the lane and to get the right rock in his hand. Belmonte advances to face Rhino Page in the title match in Indy. Super Tuesday presented by Cree LED Lighting. At 7, the pursuit of perfection continues for Kentucky as John Calipari's Cats battle the upset-minded Vols. Number 1, Kentucky versus Tennessee at 7, then Michigan State versus Michigan Tuesday on ESPN. Part of Rivalry Week presented by Wendy's. Today's Ebonite Flashback is the number 1 moment in Tournament of Champions history as voted on by the fans. Kelly Kulick's historic win. Not a dry eye in the house on that day at Red Rock.
She was pretty incredible that day.
As voted on by the fans, Kulick, the top moment, Pete Weber, Mika Koivuniemi just missing out, the all-time classic prior to that, Don Johnson's 299, and then Jason Couch, three straight.
There you go, you got your wish.
Pretty good live telecast as Rhino Page takes on Belmonte uninterrupted next. Woodland Bowl in Indianapolis, Indiana, host of the Barbasol PBA Tournament of Champions, Mike Jakubowski with Randy Peterson and Kimberly Pressler.
Mike, guess what time it is, Mike?
Geico Championship recap.
Sean Rash, Scott Norton, first match. Scott Norton gets up in the 10th frame, and he can strike out to beat Rash by one. He leaves a shaker seven, and Sean Rash advances. Match number two, he takes on Ryan Ciminelli, but it was the Sean Rash show. There's the first one in the 10th. Second one in the 10th. And here's for perfection. There it is. Sean Rash becomes the first player in PBA history to bowl two perfect games on TV. Then in the match you just saw, Jason Belmonte and Sean Rash. Sean gets up in the 9th frame, and it's devastation, a 2-8-10 split. He would fail to convert. Belmonte steps up in the 10th, yes, throws a nice double, yes, shuts the door. Belmonte moves on to face Rhino Page in the title match.
Tournament leader Rhino Page has been waiting quite a bit, but he gets Jason Belmonte, the number one and two matchup championship match. Rhino elects to begin on the left lane. Let's go. It went. Strike. Opening shot.
Take a look at the oil pattern once again and see where the traffic has been throughout this championship. Belmonte's already in this zone here, and Rhino Page is feeding it. Well, you can see it right there in between second and third arrow. There's where Jason Belmonte's playing.
Belmo strikes. Cannot overestimate what he did with Rash in the previous match. He bided his time, he waited, he made the ball change, and he rode it to victory.
He also kept his emotions in check. Remember, we saw the footage of him talking to his tour reps. He says, I'm okay, there's time. Sean Rash gave him the time, gave him the opportunity, then the big split. Jason Belmonte took advantage of it, and that's why he's bowling for the title.
Another title, another major title. Second frame. Double for Belmonte.
Well, since he made the ball change, he's thrown, let me do the quick math for you. Well, he's thrown the last 8 out of 9 strikes.
Rhino Page overcoming the wrist surgery. All of the rehab, he started with 8-pound equipment. Every 6 weeks, he'd move up 2 pounds, Randy, in terms of the weight of the ball. He's worked his backside off to get back. Go. 7 pitches.
So Rhino's a real feel-good story out here. And, you know, having gone through the same type of issues, only with my knee instead of my wrist, I know exactly where he was and where he is now. But it's good to see Rhino back. He's such a talented guy. I mean, who can forget his rookie campaign when he basically...
That's a spare.
He was named Rookie of the Year in 2008, but I mean, it was a rookie campaign that we had never seen before. He earned over $84,000 and... You know, he made a bunch of shows that year, and just it was just incredible to watch, and you knew he was something special. And then, you know, this wrist injury, followed by surgery, just pretty much almost ended his career.
And he changed his style as well. It's a third frame.
Oh,
four around the seven.
Flat seven, ring seven. That's good. Never a good look or a good sign for anybody. Now he's going to start second guessing his ball choice. Four pin up and around the seven, and on the right lane it was the flat seven.
That was better.
Unfortunately for Rhino, he made three pretty good shots. He's only got one strike to show for it, and up steps in the third frame the monster from Australia.
started 1 of 5 and since then 8 of 9, and that was after the ball change.
No 7-10. Strike for Belmonte.
This ball goes through the pins so hard and so fast. Watch the pin action. 7-10's up. I'm not even sure what hit the 7-pin. And the 10-pin, well, there was just like a melee over into the 10-pin spot. That was scary fast.
Randy's got a look in his eyes. Everything he does is scrutinized. Every player has this man's name in a sentence at some point. He is just pasting this tour. Fourth frame.
Oh. You know, somebody asked me this week why I didn't bowl the Tournament of Champions. Well, you're looking at the reason why I didn't bowl the Tournament of Champions. I have no chance of beating this guy.
Cross lane two-handed pick above the 10-pin. Kimberly Pressler is lane side with Sean Rash.
Thanks, Mike. Sean, you came off a perfect game. You started your match with Belmo, and then your carry went away a bit. What changed for you?
Well, a couple things happened. The transition from him's practice shots and not getting to throw a few extra. So I had to make a move in the middle of the game, and pretty unfortunate to not carry or get something for me. So Belmo's bowling really good. He's been bowling good for a few years, and he's, like he said before, you're riding the wave, and he's been bolting, like he's just doing it.
Well, it's still a very memorable tournament for you. Thank you so much for your time and congratulations. Guys, back to you.
Talk about the intensity of Belmonte. Rhino Page. When I think of Page, I think intensity.
Oh, yeah, without question. Rhino's a pretty intense young man. I think there's a couple of things that he's got really working for him. One, he's able to be really focused and stay really focused. But two, in speaking with Del Ballard Jr., he's probably got the best shoulder move in the sport, meaning that his shoulders don't really do a whole lot to manipulate the bowling ball or his swing and the downswing especially.
Tie, baby split, the 2 and the 7.
You know, we talked about this at our production meetings, about 3 left-handers on one show and all the traffic that they're just not used to seeing. Rhino throws a shot, and I promise you, he thought he threw this shot really good. It goes through the nose.
Great spare from Page. He came into this tournament on an all-time low, Randy. Mentally fatigued, he bowled poorly in Milwaukee and Green Bay. And Norm Duke helped him out. As we look at the hammer tough spare replay, Norm Duke giving Rhino a hand.
Well, he was staying with Norm Duke and Norm's wife, Karen, while he was waiting for, while he was waiting to close on his new place. And what better mentor could there be than Norm Duke?
Belmonte plus 20 in the fifth. That slaps out the 10 pin. Proprietor here, longtime supporter of professional bowling in Indianapolis, Jim Doty. We congratulate you on Woodland Bowl and the great renovation. Kenny Howard to the right, his longtime manager here, Jim, from Royal Pin Centers. This bowling facility, Randy, complete facelift.
It's a beautiful place. If not for anything else, I have great memories here. I won in this building. It's really nice to always come back to Woodland Bowl in Indianapolis.
Key shot of the match. Belmonte can increase his lead, 6th frame. Messenger gets the 10.
Just slinging wood. That's a bad dude right there. This guy gargles peanut butter and blows bubbles with beef jerky. I mean, this is just a bad mammal. Look at that. That's ridiculous.
Page up six frame, needs to find some strikes. Has yet to double. Championship match.
Oh.
Four around the seven.
Yeah, there's three ball, three balls that have left his hand that hit the pocket. Two ringing sevens, one flat seven. And that's what makes players talk to themselves, like Rhino's doing right now. He's like, I mean, you know, what do I do now? You start blinking real fast. You start talking to yourself. People start looking at you funny. And that's what bad carry does to a professional bowler.
Here's a look at what's in Rhino's arsenal. He's opting for the high road 7.0. What are Rhino's options here? We saw Belmonte do it in the previous game. Can Page do the same here?
Mike, that's a great question, and it's a question that I'm sorry that I cannot answer. I'm not left-handed. His ball reaction looks fine, but you know he throws one on this left lane, getting up on this left lane. The last time he thought he threw it pretty good, he goes through the nose and leaves it 2-7. I don't know.
Page has got to find out quick. Seventh frame. Mixing, no, 7-9 split.
So he moves off of the high hit, and now the ball doesn't react. I think he needs to throw a stronger bowling ball. Move more towards the center part of the lane. He waited so long for his opportunity, only to come out and not have a great ball reaction. And then when he does hit the pocket, his ball doesn't strike. Well, this is what makes Jason Belmonte so fun to watch. And it's this type of carry. And he does something with a bowling ball that you and I just can't do. And that's why he's so exciting and so fun to watch. He's so different. And he's a proven winner. He just throws pins around like they're made out of balsa wood. It's fun to watch.
Seventh frame.
He makes it look, he makes a technique that's not very easy to do look very easy. I mean, folks, he's not the only guy throwing it with two hands, but he's so head and shoulders better than everybody else that's trying it.
Randy, are we seeing the greatest run in this sport?
We talked about it last night. I can't remember a run in the majors, anything like this. Remember what I said. If he doesn't lose to Weber in 2013, he wins three of these in a row.
Yes! Yes!
Came back against Sean Rash to throw the last six in a row to win that match. And you're looking at your 2015 tournament champions winner, your defending champion, Jason Belmonte. You think that finger hurts right now? Promise you it doesn't. He doesn't even know it's there. He's going to spit on it and throw more strikes.
Rhino Page with a great return to championship form. All the work after surgery, rehabbing, physical therapy, putting himself back into a position to win. Unfortunately, a second place finish. What a great story out here on the PBA Tour. Of perseverance and guts.
Absolutely. You know, there's your ball change. A little late, but you know, it's just a sign of great things to come for Rhino Page. It's good to see. It's good for bowling. And obviously, really good for his psyche. You know, it's really bad for your psyche, bowling against this guy.
A lot of folks can say that on the PBA Tour, since this man visited the States from down under.
Oh, I used to say that there's only two things that could stop Jason Belmonte, and that was bad carry and an act of God. Well, you just saw one of them right there.
Belmonte will get the victory lap. and it's amazing to recount. He just won his third consecutive Masters. This is back-to-back at the Tournament of Champions. This is back-to-back years where he won the Masters and the Tournament of Champions in the same year.
My man right there.
Here comes some Barbasol for you. He's got to pull the 10th frame with Shami Cremont. Hey, wait a minute. Wonder if he can get DQ'd for that. Little Barbasol for a guy that a razor hasn't seen his face in about 6 years.
It's okay.
This is just an amazing run. Jason Belmonte. has gone back to back at the Barbasol PBA Tournament of Champions. It's his fifth major title. And there are two players that have 10 major titles. And now Jason Belmonte is halfway in his career. He's got five majors and 12 PBA Tour titles. And
Rhino's got some shaving cream on his head. That's great.
Thank you, Storm. Thank you very much, Bill Chrisman. I owe you so much.
Rhino Page finishing up in the 10th, a second place finish, and a return to championship form for Page.
Great to have you back, Rhino. Proud of you.
Page completes his 10th frame, and Jason Belmonte has done it. He's gone back to back at the Tournament of Champions, his fifth major and 12th PBA Tour title. PBA Tour history. Jason Belmonte is rewriting the way you look at the sport of bowling, the way you throw the ball. He's done it all. He is dominating the greatest bowlers in the world. He is the greatest bowler in the world. And Kimberly Pressler will catch up with him when we return to Indianapolis. The 50th Barbasol PBA Tournament of Champions is brought to you by AMF. Roll this way. By the USBC, a future for the sport. By Barbasol, life is full of close shaves. Make sure your close shave is a Barbasol close shave. And by hotelplanner.com, the best place to book hotel rooms. Best rooms, best rate, guaranteed.
Which one to give it to.
Jason Belmonte awarding the game ball to Belmo fans in the stands here at Woodland Bowl. That is a very valuable souvenir. Jason Belmonte back-to-back at the Tournament of Champions. Historical win on the PBA Tour. Final score 232 to 214 over the great comeback of Rhino Page to championship bowling. Let's go down for the trophy presentation. Lakeside.
Thanks, Mike. I'm also here with Dean Bring from Barbasol for the trophy presentation.
On behalf of Barbasol and the PBA, congratulations once again.
Thank you so much, Dean. Thank you for sponsoring us. I really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Oh, Jason, are you getting sick of being up here? Because this is 2 weeks in a row. This may sound familiar, but what's it like to win back-to-back majors?
I don't know what is going on, Kimberly. I don't care. I am in a dream state, and I hope I stay in this dream for a very long time. I'm just lost for words, and I just can't wait to get back home. And Kimberly, Aria, Hugo, I know you're up in Australia watching. I love you guys like you can't believe. I'll be home soon, and we'll be drinking something out of this later on.
Now, how much are you savoring these moments?
Look, this is something when you retire and you look back, you want to be able to remember them. And that's one of the things that I do out here. I look around and I take it all in, because it's a privilege to be a part of the PBA, and it's a privilege to be on these lanes to bowl for my career and for my living. So I'm in debt to everyone that has anything to do with the PBA to give us a stage to do this. So thank you to everyone, and follow your dreams, kids. You just never know where it might take you.
Great words to live by. Congratulations, Jason Belmonte, in winning back-to-back Tournament of Champions.
Randy, when you think of the PBA, you think of names like Weber, Anthony, Carter, many others. Belmonte is now unquestionably on that list among the all-time greats.
Well, there's no question. And he's on an incredible run. And he's a phenom. And phenoms only come around once every 20 or 30 years. So stay tuned, folks. You're going to see a lot more of Jason Belmonte. He is our superstar.
He has revolutionized the sport of bowling. Coming up next Sunday on ESPN, it's the PBA Players Championship. Jason Belmonte qualified third there. Tournament leader is Parker Bone III. Sean Rash with the 25th perfect game, but not enough to beat Belmonte and make the title match. Jason Belmonte runs away and wins back-to-back. For Randy Peterson and Kimberly Pressler, this is Mike Jakubowski. Congratulations to Jason Belmonte, all-time great. So long from Indianapolis.